Hi friends, Prepared Suburbanite here. First I want to give you all a big apology for not having as many videos out recently as I would like to have, as you've grown to expect from this channel. But life happens sometimes. So let me get into some of the details about what's been going on around here at the homestead and at Nowhere. Well, with the apology out of the way, let's get into some of the background and some of the details. About 5 weeks ago, we had our son move back in our house with us. Seems he really wasn't able to properly take care of himself, being home alone without any adult supervision, for lack of a better term. And his girlfriend brought him here. We all agreed that he could stay if he lived by our rules and kept himself out of trouble, and he's done a marvelous job. He's really adapted quite well. And over the last, he's been through now this is the third cycle he just finished up of his double chemo, which really knocks him for a loop when he gets down to the end of it. But he just finished up about a week ago with that round, has been back to the doctors, has been now cleared to be able to drive again and cleared to be able to get back to work. I suspect he's facing a mound of paperwork from his employer to get back there. He's got some news that it wasn't so positive, that the project that he was working on is being phased out, so he may or may not have his choice of projects when he gets back to work. He's in IT, so and does project support and that kind of stuff. So software support, I guess, is a better term. So, but he's anxious to get back to work. He's gotten clearance now to drive, and he's working on the paperwork to actually get back to work. As far as our bug out location goes, we've made a little progress, but not as much progress as I wanted. We've gotten the roof trusses up. We've got a big old tarp over the top just to keep the rain out. We had a period a couple, 3 weeks ago of really heavy rains, and that place up there just got soaked. All the wood got soaked, the plywood flooring got soaked, the tarps didn't really do much good at all. So we had to finish getting the roof trusses up, then we got a tarp draped over the whole thing that really does act more like a roof now than just throwing tarps over things. So it's dried out some, been tinkering around, got the floor joist in, I guess, for the second floor loft. Got all those in and got the plywood flooring down for the loft area in anticipation of being able to use the loft flooring to help put the roofing plywood and the actual roofing materials up and make it a little bit easier so that we didn't all have to be standing on ladders. So that's pretty much done. I think I got one more cut to make, and that'll be pretty well complete. My wife and I decided, well, actually I decided and brought her along with me, to take off and go up to the bug out location on Saturday morning. The weather forecast that I looked at maybe on Wednesday or Thursday said high about 70 to 73. Evening lows in the mid-40s. I said, well, that's tolerable. We can certainly deal with that. We've been camping in a lot less temperatures than that. Well, we got up there on Saturday, and it never got above 62 or 63. There was a cold north wind blowing. It misty, rained pretty much all day long. We had maybe an hour's worth of a peak of sunshine about 4 in the afternoon. Then it clouded right back up again, and just as we sat down to grab a bite to eat, around 6 o'clock, it started sprinkling again, and just misty sprinkled till it was like, oh, to hell with it. Built a little campfire, had a lot of fun with that, kind of reminiscing about around the campfire, and went to bed, had a miserable, miserable night. It was damp and it was cold. So I'm just hoping that if the shit hits the fan, the weather's nice. I guess that's kind of where I am with that. So we've gotten that ready to go. I think there's only a couple more small little details before we can pull the work party together to get up there and get the roofing materials squared away. And then we're going to be pretty much done with 98% of it. Yeah, I'll still be tinkering with trim around the windows and the corners and building in some shelving inside and stuff like that. Got a lot of clearing yet to do to make the land up there a little bit more usable, a little bit more friendly. Want to get some walking paths up there, get those kinds of things taken care of. We've taken up quite a lot of stuff already that we can afford to have up there, even though it's not fully protected. I've got a bunch of hand tools and rakes and shovels and that kind of stuff up there already. We took up a 55-gallon rain barrel because we're going to be hooking up the shed with eaves truss that run down and then into a water catchment into a rain barrel. And then we've got the Berkey filter that we'll use to filter the water in case we need to drink it. And so we've got quite a lot of the stuff up there already. Reorganized our storage area here at the house a little bit. Yesterday we decided to come back on Saturday because the weather forecast because the weather forecast wasn't any better for Sunday. Turned out to be a little bit better day, but it was still cold. It was still that darn raw north wind, and it never really got above 65 around here, and it was even chillier up north where our bug out location is. So we came back Sunday afternoon, got back about 3 so in the afternoon, and unpacked stuff, got a good night's sleep finally last night, and I've been tinkering around here, getting things reorganized and all that. But I've been doing a lot of thinking about where we really are, not just me personally, but where the prepper community really is. And a lot of things have occurred to me. One of the best venues that the prepper community had to share information, share knowledge, and share experience was right here on YouTube. And the recent YouTube changes, and yeah, I know there's been 100,000 of these videos about how bad the changes in YouTube really are. Well, this one's one more, because I really think the changes are bad. I don't do YouTube videos to raise income or anything like that. I do monetize them because there is some cost of production. There is cameras and tripods and a little bit of this and my time and all that. So I do monetize them, which you all have noticed, but I don't make a whole heck of a lot of money. And I'm making even less now. It's hardly even worth hooking up the camera, setting up the tripod, trying to figure out what to say and how to say it, because the ad revenues are just absolutely atrocious. I'm getting views. The views are good, but the ad revenue just isn't comparable to the way it was 6 months ago. This is quite a change. And I hope YouTube can begin to learn a lesson, as a lot of the better creators are now exploring other venues like Patreon, which I don't think is necessarily the best idea. But the venue, the ability to share information and knowledge and experience about being prepared, about the prepper community, about the events in this world that are going to and will eventually have a huge impact on us, whether it's economic, natural disaster, wars, famine, meteors, whatever it is, that kind of information exchange is vital. And it gets more complex every day. As you all are aware, we've just changed governments. We've got a brand new president. We've got a brand new cabinet. And things are changing. And boy, I'll tell you, the whole world is taking notice. And a lot of folks around the United States is taking notice. And a lot of folks are mobilizing. They really don't like Donald Trump. They don't like his policies. They don't like his politics. They don't like the way he does business. And they're protesting every which way but loose. They're well-funded, as I understand it. There's a lot of paid protesters that are going on out there. I can't prove it one way or another, but it sure seems logical to me that there is an incentive, some sort of financial benefit for these protesters to organize and travel around to these different events. But protesting for protesting's sake is not really going to get the job done. Stuff's going to hit the fan. What I think we've experienced over the last 8 years is a very muffled approach to world politics, to foreign and domestic policy. It's been muted. It's been pushed down below the surface. And we've all been told that everything is peaceful, everything's going to be just fine. Yeah, we've got a few issues here and there, but we're taking care of it. Don't you worry your pretty little heads. And now all of a sudden, the reality is trickling up to the surface, and we're seeing that, hey, North Korea really is a threat. The European Union is on a brink of destruction right now, which is going to have a tremendous impact on our economic future here in the United States. The Middle East is a shambles and has been for 4,000 years, and I don't think there's anything that anybody's going to be able to do to fix that. Whether we get rid of ISIS, whether we don't get rid of ISIS, they've been fighting that same war for 4,000 years. I don't know what the answers are, but the increasing threat from that kind of terrorism infiltrating our shores, infiltrating the European continent, is more than I can really deal with passively. That's why I prep. And that's why you should prepare. Being prepared isn't putting your head in the sand, isn't pretending that bad stuff is not going to happen. It's really being prepared for the eventualities. And I really believe that something untoward is going to happen. And I don't know if it's little Kim in North Korea that's going to do something stupid, if it's Putin in Russia, if it's the Chinese folks, Guatemala, Venezuela, France, Great Britain, Australia. I don't know who's going to do it, but something's going to happen, and it's going to trigger what I consider the cascade effect. And that cascade effect is going to have its fingers in so many different venues that are going to cause us to have to be prepared and ready ourselves for the change that's coming. Our current economic system simply cannot maintain the level of debt and the printing of money that we're, this whole fiat thing of money is just beyond reason. How much debt we've really got and what's going to happen to it? Because I would say that we're never going to be able to pay it back to whoever we owe it to, which is basically ourselves. It'll never get paid back, but some catastrophic event's going to happen, whether it's a marketplace meltdown, whether it's a war, whether it's a natural disaster, and all of a sudden, the slate's going to get wiped clean, and we're going to end up having to start all over again, making all the same mistakes all over again. And it just doesn't seem to ever stop. The cycle continues. I'm saying be prepared. I'm saying make sure you've got what you need to survive if you can't buy food at a supermarket, if you can't drive your vehicle anywhere because there's no gas available, that you can't get water from the tap any longer because it's contaminated, the cities have abandoned the technology, you've got to be able to survive. And you've got a responsibility not only to yourself, but to your family and to your community to reach out and make sure that they're all going to be able to survive and do the best that you can to do it. Do you have enough food? Do you have enough water? Do you have enough resources available to you? And I'm talking resources, skill sets and experience. Do you know how to garden? Do you know how to farm? Do you know where you can find water that doesn't come out of the tap when you open up this kitchen sink? Do you know where to go get the water? Do you know how to purify the water? Do you know how to keep warm when it's cold? Do you know where you can get available wood? So if you've got a wood stove, can you get wood? Have you got a chainsaw? Have you got a felling axe? Are you able to keep yourself warm in the wintertime? Thankfully, I live in North Carolina and the winters are actually pretty mild here. But I wouldn't want to try to tackle surviving the winter in the New England states, Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, Michigan, up in the very northern parts up there. It's brutally cold. And my friends in Canada, they're going to be facing a lot of challenges if we're not going to be able to enjoy life as we enjoy it today. So we've got to be prepared. I think I learned a lesson when we went camping this weekend, that if you're going to bug out, and you're going to have to bug out, and you have to leave your homestead, and you have to go set up shop, set up life in an environment where you're not 100% familiar, where it's not 100% stocked up, where you don't have all the little details kind of worked out yet, it's going to be a tough struggle. We were hurting when we woke up on Sunday morning. Our bones were aching, our joints were aching. We were chilled to the bone, got a fire going, got some coffee brewing, all that. And by 10 o'clock or so, we were sort of back to normal, but we were exhausted because we didn't get a good night's sleep. Well, imagine continuing that for days and days and weeks upon months, if that's the way you're going to have to live. So another level of preparedness has entered into my marketplace, into our priorities, that I've got to be able to get our bug out location set so that when we go there, if we have to go there, if the shit hits the fan, I want to be able to make sure that I'm going to be able to survive there and do it with at least some dignity. And we'll see how that works out. This is the Prepared Suburbanite, reminding you to be prepared always. And I'm out for now. See you on the next video.